Hey, this is Charles Peterson. You're listening to the State of Love and Trust.
Welcome, everyone, to another episode of The State of Love and Trust. It's a Pearl Jam podcast, and I'm one of your two hosts, Jason Kerepesi, and alongside me, as always, is
Paul Ghiglieri.
Paul, we are here in the thick of it. It's early February. The Super Bowl is nearly upon us, and we are getting very excited for a very exciting interview in just mere moments.
Yeah, you know, the Super Bowl is all about capturing that moment. And I'm going to segue to myself on that and, say that this episode is very much about a gentleman who has made a living on capturing the moment.
Yes. And if you couldn't tell, we are recording this before the Super Bowl, even though this episode is coming out after the Super Bowl. So you're hearing this, and yeah. Paul could either be really sad or really happy as you're listening to it.
I know. Right now, Paul is optimistic, right? So you're either laughing at me while you listen, or you are joining me in reveling and the rapture that is a Super Bowl victory. I don't know what's going to happen, man.
Who knows? Thank you for being here, everybody. This is it's our first interview that we've recorded in 2024, but the second to come out this calendar year. It features photographer Charles Peterson. If you don't know who Charles is, he has taken a number of photos that you know very, very well. And we're gonna show you that interview. We're gonna tee up the interview in just a moment here. Just again, a quick thank you to you guys for coming on and listening, and anybody who has joined our Patreon. We really appreciate you guys. You help us pay these hosting bills and all the other stuff, keeping this show alive. Anyone who's bought a t-shirt, one of our three t-shirts, that as well helps keep this show afloat. So if you want to do either of those things, get in our DMs or get to the link in our bio, and that will be sorted. Okay, enough of that. Paul, are we excited?
We are excited, almost as excited as those of you who take the time to rate, review, and subscribe on your preferred podcast platform of choice. Feed that algorithm. And maybe Charles will take a picture of it.
You got through it. That's what matters.
I got through it.
Now, I do want to say that today is February 13th as you're listening to this. And I think stuff is happening. So if the stuff is happening, we'll talk about it soon, but right now, let's get to our interview and the incomparable Charles Peterson. Here it is. All right, and here he is. I will say legendary photographer of many things, but most notably for our listeners, musicians, bands, Nirvana, Pearl Jam, Soundgarden, Mudhoney, Tad, whoever else was kicking ass and taking names in Seattle back in the 80s and 90s. It's Charles Peterson.
Hi, nice to be here.
Excited to have you, Charles. Welcome.
Thank you.
So yeah. We have to say out of the gate that we're both very excited about this book that's coming out in a week, Charles Peterson's Nirvana. Can you tell me how long this has been in the process of making?
Well, in the actual physical process, it's been almost going on 2 years now. In the sort of mental, spiritual process, it's been a good half dozen years.
I was going to say.
yeah, it just took me a while to work up to it. I've made stabs at it for, and people have asked for it for years now. And I just didn't feel like I was there yet or didn't know how to bring the material together to make it my own, mm-hmm. make it unique. I didn't want to do a history of the band per se, because I don't have their complete history. I kind of for many various reasons, and we could go into it, but I didn't photograph their later period, the last period, except for a few a photo session and this and that, the in utero back cover collage, that sort of thing. So it's really a look at more of their earlier years, but it's essentially a dozen shows that have been combined to just make one incredible kick-ass show in a book of art photos.
Fantastic.
Yeah.
Well,
you know, there's very few words. It's really, it's image driven. It's, it's very much an artist book. It's printed like an artist book. It's gorgeous. It's a living testament, in my opinion, to the music and the band.
Awesome. Well, we got some Nirvana questions in there in a little bit.
But we can talk about whatever you like too.
We've got the gamut here for you, Charles.
Okay, so great.
Hopefully, it's not too many things you've talked about before.
I'd actually rather not talk about Nirvana right now because fantastic. I'm doing a lot of interviews for the book.
we're losing all Kirk questions, Paul. No, just kidding.
No. I'm just joking.
So, I mean, the first time that I came across your name was on the PlayState book that you did with your colleague and friend Lance Mercer that came out in 1999. And when you open the book, there's that first kind of title page, right? And on the left third of the page is a picture of Eddie Vedder singing basically on his head. And you are fairly infamous for a photo of Kurt Cobain playing guitar while seemingly on his head as well. It was the cover of your Screaming Life book. Coincidence or planned, Mr. Peterson?
Well, I would say that is a coincidence. I think that might be a Lance Mercer shot. So,
but it was. I'm just saying, you guys together were figuring.
Well,
it
yeah,
out,
so. No, I mean, it's really, you know, it was what we were doing was just a reaction to what the bands were doing as well. So it's pretty unavoidable that we were going to end up with some similar scenarios or images in that way. Yeah. Yeah, I mean, we were just, as Lance probably said, we were just making it up as we went along.
It's the best stuff.
Yeah. Which I imagine can be a little challenging in such an intense and frenetic setting if you are an introvert, which is something that you've said that you are, or you were at least. Mm-hmm. I'm curious, as a photographer of people, is that a source of conflict for you? You know, that is that something you had to overcome when the bands went on stage and they were doing their thing? Like,
I think it was always an issue more off stage than when in the moment. It's like it's similar to in the way that Kurt or Chris Cornell or whoever, a lot of these guys were somewhat introverted wallflowers, and so when you got on the stage, that was the moment that you blossomed, you know, in bloom, so to speak. I think it was my reaction too. It was like, okay, here we go, and this is like everything falls away, you know, all your anxieties, and it's just you're focused on the music and the job and what's happening. So it was a good mix that way. I think it was more like the introvert thing comes in and it's like, oh my God, I've got to like schmooze with this manager and this record person and do all this other stuff that has nothing to do with making art. That's what I didn't really enjoy that much, or still don't.
Yeah, that can be difficult, especially if you're not the kind of person that wants to like go and meet somebody new that isn't kind of like on your level as far as like creativity. Like if it's a band member, okay, like I get you, we are creating something. But if it's like a suit, you're like, all right.
Yeah. 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 They want something that it's just like, that's not what I do it's shallow.
But you're a one man band. So you kind of have to wear all the hats.
Oh yeah, for sure.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And at a certain point, I just stopped wearing so many of them. Yeah.
So let's go back in time. I don't want to do any origin story stuff because you've done that to death. Now, at University of Washington, you met Mark Arm, leader of Green River and Mudhoney, of course. And I spoke with Mark a couple months ago, actually. And what I want to know is, what's something about Mark that's totally different now? And what's something that's completely the same about him to this day?
Oh my God. Well, let's see. What's completely the same is his sarcastic sense of humor. I mean, that just has run through it, you know? And to me, that's like Mark. In fact, in the back of the Nirvana book, I have a singular thank you to Mark, because in my opinion, he was the match that started it all, at least very much for me, but I think the entire scene. And I was just actually commenting on a Facebook post about this recently, that somebody was like, oh, who's the OG, what's the origin? And people were like, oh, Duff McKagan or this person. And I'm like, no, Mark Arm. Because it's just like not only the bands that he was in, but also the fact that he was such a cheerleader. And if you look at any of my audience photos, it's like, oh, yeah, there's Mark. You know, it doesn't matter who the band or the show or whatever. He was there. And I don't think he gets heralded enough for that.
He's a fan of music. I saw Mudhoney play here in L.A. a few months ago, and he was out there during the opening band set, just watching. I was standing a foot away. I'm like, he just watched the whole set.
No, and I mean, we were we were roommates in college in 84, and we had our record collections, and at the same time we were listening to Black Flag. We were like listening to Brian Eno, Can, and The Birthday Party, and you know, Millions of Dead Cops and Butthole Surfers. And so it was really like this crazy, and or John Cale or the Velvet Underground. I mean, we had this great musical education going on amongst ourselves.
We spoke at the outset, Charles, about the book, you know, this new book you have coming out about Nirvana, due out February 20th. I figure we could dive in a little bit here with some of the stuff you've said in regards to the early days, specifically Nirvana, that you wished that you had taken more photos, just of the bands that were performing and their concerts, but of, like, you know, candid shots, everyday life. You know, what do you find so captivating about the downtime with musicians? You know, those moments in between.
Well, I think that's just human nature. Everybody, for whatever reason, just because it's a moment that most people don't get to see, which is, I guess, why most fans are fascinated by that. They do see the band out on stage, and so they don't see that. And it's often, though, honestly, a lot of it's really boring. You know, it's not often as glamorous as you would imagine. And particularly if a band like Nirvana is, you know, at that later period when they're quite dysfunctional to a degree off stage. I remember, you know, hanging out in concrete stadiums and no one's to be seen, no one's around, like they're just everyone's, and it's happened with Pearl Jam, it's happened with, you know, it's just hey, the band is playing and they're tired or they need to go do whatever, like, okay, like you just are there with, you know, yourself. It's a little different, say, in like 96 when I was like with Pearl Jam in Europe, like actively as practically a member of the band, where we, you know, there was only a dozen of us that flew on the private plane between gigs. And then in that case, it was like Eddie was like, I want you to be with the band every minute and shoot everything. And yeah.
It's funny you mentioned that. It's the next thing I want to ask you about. A lot of that is documented in Play State, the aforementioned book. And, you know, there is a story out there that you've told about Portugal and Ed. And I'm wondering if you'd be willing to tell our listeners who may have not heard that story, something to do with maybe duct tape and jumping somewhere.
Oh, yeah. When Eddie, there's actually a few great stories from Portugal that last night in Cache. And so Ed, yeah, he was going to climbed up the PA. But before he did that, I saw him up on stage, like with a roll of duct tape, and he was wrapping it around his boots and then up around his pants. And then he climbed up the stack and jumped into the audience, and I got the shot. And then afterwards, I was like, Ed, what were you doing with your boots? And he's like, those are my favorite boots. And I don't know what I'd do without if somebody put them on these Blundstones, and like what he would do for the, because he was going to Rome to visit some friends after that. And he's like, I can't travel without my freaking boots. So, and then what's funny is then a bunch of us got back to the hotel in a separate van, and we're in the lobby having a drink. And then, I hear, Ed's van or the band's van is showing up. So when we showed up, there was a whole line of fans on either side of the stairwell. So I ran out, got to the top of the stairwell. Eric Johnson pulls Eddie, the tour manager, pulls Eddie out, throws him over Eric's shoulder, and runs up the steps and into the lobby. And they're like, out of the way, Ed's hurt, out of the way.
And
it was really just—it was really just a way to get past the fans without having to, you know, sign.
What was the reason that he did that fireman's carry?
Because of the jump. They were like kind of playing off the massive jump that he did off the PA that night at the end of the show. So,
faking injury.
I have to dig those photos out and publish them someday, but it's pretty funny because the fans are in on it. They're all laughing.
Yeah. You have any photos of Scrabble boards? Like what's your what's the most intense Scrabble memory you got from those epic battles?
It was the second to last night in Portugal. And Eddie and I stayed up late playing. And that was an epic game. We were into the 300s, both of us.
Oh, my God.
Yeah, yeah.
A couple of wordsmiths over here.
Yeah, I know. Both nerdy dudes, man. Yeah.
who usually won?
I won.
You won.
I won that night. Yeah.
Okay.
Only by a few points, but I won. Yeah.
All right.
But it was split pretty evenly. You know, but yeah, by the end there, we were like, you know, it was kind of bad because it was maybe a little bit too much of a distraction for me and what I was supposed to be doing. But we would go and run and get on the plane, and Eddie and I would reserve the little table. And before the plane was had even taken off, we'd be like halfway through a Scrabble game.
That's intense. It's very nerdy, but it's intense. I like it.
So much for the whole like Motley Crue, like, you know, hookers and eight balls and stuff.
I don't know. I mean, one day, Charles, we may find out that you and those games were the inspiration behind some of the lyrics on Yield. You know,
how do I use that? Why? Yeah, Yield.
There it is. I want to ask about choosing which frames to move into like the next phase of editing, like versus, you know, which to let go. That can be a kind of a difficult process. And you've said that you're a high hit photographer. An analogy I can only think of is like a batter in baseball batting like 400, like someone that's just really prolific with hits. Does it bug you, as you said, to quote, kill your babies? And when you're putting out a book like you are with Nirvana, is there like a B-side, a companion piece you could put together and sell like alongside it or something? Like, too many good photos to leave out, right?
Yeah, that's that has been brought up. We're not there yet.
Okay.
We need to get through this one first, but no, certainly. And that initially, with this publisher who I've known for a long time, and she's a local, it's a small art photo imprint. And we talked about doing a retrospective. This was pre-COVID. And I dragged my feet. I just couldn't get my head around it because I have just too much material. So I was like, okay, like Nirvana book, I can finally, like, I have too much to do this other thing that I wanted to do. So, okay, yes, I will do the Nirvana book. And I thought, okay, well, that should be doable, you know. And, you know, yeah, I had about 300 images printed out to choose from, whittled it down, finally down to 90. But when I started it, the family went on vacation for a couple weeks in France. And I took over the house and just had strips of photos running, you know, crazy in a line through the living room, into the kitchen, into the dining room, etc. And just played Nirvana for 2 weeks and just shuffled pictures around and then be like, oh, that one, it actually, and then run back down to the files and print something out. You know, I was just making kind of office prints really, and just, but just, and then that way I kind of came up with the idea of breaking it up into sections with song titles, and then having just a visual flow, not necessarily a full narrative flow to it. And that's how you have to do it, really, is just print it out. And yeah. And so I think some people may have, there may not be in the book what some people were expecting, which in the end, I jettisoned most of the backstage and post photos. There's just a few at the beginning and the end, but I really wanted it to be about the music, an expression, an emotional expression of the music. So even after the title page, you open it up and it says, play this book loud. That's kind of the idea, is just, yeah, throw on the record and then go through it again.
Very cool. There's a while back, and then there's turning 60. So let's talk about social media and marketing in the digital age, and you know, obviously stark contrast, I think, to the way things were done when you were shooting for Sub Pop. Jason and I were younger than 60, but not considerably younger. We're over 40. There's a lot, I think, to social media and that game that is probably beyond even us, and probably many of our listeners, if we're being honest. You said Instagram is exhausting to you, and I understand. I mean, it can be exhausting for anybody, really, but what caught our eye is that you said people need to edit themselves more. So can you elaborate on what you meant by that?
Yeah. I mean, I think if it could just be Instagram, or if it could just be Twitter, or just, but it's the fact that there's, you have to like cater to so many of them. And I mean, that's not even talking about LinkedIn, or, you know, and now there's new ones popping up that people are like, get away from Twitter, go over here, you know? And it's like, oh my God. Like, yeah, just starting all over again.
As
far as the editing thing goes, like, I don't want to point anyone out, but there are photographers that will go and shoot a show and then they post 75 images.
Okay.
And What are we supposed to do with that? You know, when one or two like really like just show your like greatest images, or yeah. And if you don't have them, don't show them at all. But
it's like, what's your Afghan girl with the green eyes moment, right? Like, find
yeah,
that.
Exactly.
Like, that
yeah, exactly.
That's your. There. That's it'll speak yeah, volumes.
Or what's your? my case. What's your iconic stage diver, or you know, yeah. thing? Right. Kurt on his back, but yeah, it's a people. It's too easy to just say to get lost in what I call representation. So you're just merely representing the moment. You're not actually trying to bring something else to it that's either, you know, an emotion or a representation of the music, or part of the problem is the cameras have gotten too good. And the lighting, it's all this like really strong LED lighting now. So you can, you know, go up there and have these perfectly, yeah, they're almost like you're making an iPhone photo. They're like these perfectly lit, you know, not blurry, not, you know, in focus, etc. And I mean, as a photographer, it's great to get things in focus.
Yeah,
it's
just, we don't get gems like this, though, do we? We're not going to get a gem like this.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. You know, and that's kind of like with the Nirvana book, you'll see I went through and picked out a lot of images that are more expressive. At one point, I started to think too much about it and was like, oh, I really need just this picture of Kurt at the microphone. You know, people want that. And it's like, Michelle's like, no, because that's not your art, dude. That's like, you know, everybody else is doing that. So let's get back to your art. Let's make it an art book. Let's make it unique and stand alone.
I think that's what
people,
right?
I tell young photographers is just find your vision. Yeah. Don't saturate everyone with just like find your vision and keep some mystery to it as well.
It's the iceberg effect, right? Show people the 10%. Don't show them.
Yeah.
Me.
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
That's a good point.
Uh-huh. Yeah. Yeah.
I love that dichotomy though, that you just pointed out, this idea that if photography is reduced to just representing something as opposed to interpreting it and then producing or manifesting an expression that was internalized. It's almost like you see something and you are processing it and then you are capturing it in a way that is reflective, not of the band that you're shooting, right? But more reflective of your perspective or reflective of your process, because it's not really art if it's just representation. You know what I mean?
Yeah, so
it's really fascinating the way that you broke that down.
Yeah, and I think with the Nirvana book, it is Nirvana, but in a sense, it could be anybody, and that's sort of what I was going after. Mm. Yeah, it just I didn't want it to be, a Kurt-centric book per se, or oh, here's happy Kurt, here's moody Kurt, here's the whole arc of tragedy, this and that, and I just wanted it to be like this, like. Kick in the gut, like it was when you were like, you know, bruising your knees on the front of the stage back in 1990. Just wanted really like what was the music about and what is the lasting power of it?
You know, Charles, you've spoken about unguarded emotion being the key to great shots before. That can seemingly be easy when it's a candid, but it's hard to do with portraits, I think. Can you explain how you're able to kind of unguard someone in those moments?
Yeah. It helps. Well, a lot of the times I'm not actually looking through the camera.
Mm.
I will, you know, set it up, focus, kind of like take it away, having a discussion, which sometimes can backfire, particularly if you have, say, somebody like my good friend Kim Thale, who just loves to talk, and then you end up with just these pictures of somebody talking and talking, and
yeah.
but it's a matter of finding the moment after the moment, you know, like you've got that, like, okay, idealize, but like, what's more interesting? Like sometimes, like when the subject closes their eyes and then you're allowed to actually kind of look at them without them looking back at you. There's this weird thing that happens. Sometimes, yeah. Or seeing somebody from the back or a different angle, and just finding that relaxed moment. And sometimes, yeah, it's like, you've got to just, the angle might be weird or the focus might be off or it's blurry, but that's because it's raw and unique, and I'm a very
perfection can be boring, right?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And what is perfection? Yeah.
Well, what's the opposite of that, right? I guess the opposite would be what you've called informed luck. Right. Uh-huh. So I'm kind of curious, when you talk about something like informed luck when composing a photo, can you first like define that, but then can you also think of an equivalent moment in your time shooting Pearl Jam where you would say, hey, that's an example of informed luck, that moment right there?
Yeah. So what I mean is that you are so practiced in your craft that special things will come to you, and that's the luck aspect. And it's a matter of showing up and being ready. And it's very much what an athlete does as well. Or and I'm trying to think of a moment with Pearl Jam. Well, I mean for example, we were talking about the jump that he did in Cachet off the PA, and I knew just how to set up for that. And and the situation wasn't ideal. Like, I would rather have had to switch out lenses or do this or that. But I knew enough, and I didn't look through the viewfinder when he jumped off there, just because I know my camera well enough exactly how to angle it and point it. Now that's not luck. That's not luck per se.
It's experience, though. You've been through enough
experience.
You know how to be ready for it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Well, because of your familiarity with that camera, you were able to capture that moment in the moment without having to say, and you're trying to position yourself, and then it's gone. You know what I mean?
Yeah. No, I always say, like, just take the picture, like, no matter what, take the picture. If your focus isn't ready, or just take it. You know,
especially now, Charles, because you could just put all 75 of them on Instagram.
Yeah, anyway. Yeah. I mean, another example of luck in my pictures is like the cover of the Nirvana book here. You can see at the very tip of his guitar is a blurry light, with my technique of flash freezing the subject and then open shutter capturing whatever ambient lights there happen to be. But it's just that it's like having done it over, and I didn't plan it, because you can't actually see these things happening.
Yeah.
But it's just a matter of like knowing, like from past experience, well, I don't want to move the camera too much, or I don't want to in this situation, or maybe I do, you know? So you can just kind of, it's a feel, it's a feeling. It's a craft that you just have to,
By doing that, Charles, you have found a way, and I think other photographers in their own way have done this as well, where you are adding, by that technique, the action, the energy of that shot, even though it's a still. You get a sense, obviously anybody can get Kurt doing this, like a baseball player, but you see that flare, that light streak from the exposure, and you feel like, wow, this was powerful, this was a moment.
It feels like kinetic energy.
Yeah. When did you realize that that could be your thing? Like, did you stumble upon that early on, or did you know that you could do that?
I actually discovered that technique when I was in high school from looking at a book of Gary Winogrand, a classic 60s street photographer who photographed these rodeos down in Dallas using a similar, not quite to the extreme that I would take it, but I was like, wow, how did he do that? And then I kind of, you know, back then you couldn't jump on the internet. You had to like really kind of research these things and try it for yourself. And then I brought that into photographing bands. And at one point I really, like, I think with Green River, like really took it to the extreme. Green River's first promo shot that Bruce used was, you couldn't even really see the band. It was so blurry. And then I would sort of at times dial it back a little bit, and it kind of work with it. Another cool effect that would happen sometimes, is that I would have a 1 or 2 second shutter speed. So the shutter was open for that long and somebody else's flash would go off at that.
Oh, cool.
Time. So you get a double ghost image. Yeah.
I want to jump back to something real quick that we were talking before about editing yourself, right? Editing down. And you know, you talk about how you have to ask yourself, well, I love this photo, but will everyone else? And I think it's interesting because many bands like Pearl Jam will write music they love with no one in mind, like no thought to what the listener might want to hear. It's whatever makes them happy. How do you square those two approaches?
So that's called second guessing yourself, and that's what I started to do, and that never works out well. You know, it's fine if you're wanting to, if you need to make a fashion catalog or something. You know, I don't know. Yeah, then you need to like, if you've got a client that you need to cater to, that's one thing. But if you're making art, never try and make it for an audience. You've got to make it because it's freaking good. That's why. Because you're good and what you're doing is good. And you've got to be your own hardest critic as well to really find out like what's important, like what's working here, you know, and what's going to make you set you apart from everybody else. I don't know. I just want to make pictures that are iconic and last a lifetime. And
well, see, that's interesting though, Charles, because you said that part of your intention with the Nirvana book was for it to feel like it could be any band. Right. So it was on one hand, one would say, oh, so he's kind of like eschewing, you know, the iconic images. He's trying to go for something that's less iconic and more of that authenticity. Right. But now you're saying you're looking for the iconic. So it do you think?
But you see, the iconic images are the ones that transverse time and space. Mm-hmm. Whereas the non-iconic images are just like, oh, Kurt, Chris and Dave, like chatting with each other backstage or whatever.
I see.
So that is the representation that just puts you, okay, yeah.
There you go. Here's back to that.
For the train spotters, like, oh, here they are. You know.
Then where do you draw the line, though, between those just representing the guys chatting versus like, oh, this is the time between the time that shows personality that no one's seeing. Like, where's that? Is that a gray area or do you always know?
That's certainly a gray area for sure. And, I think that by, like, for example, with the Nirvana book, we just use a couple of band shots at the beginning, and then there's a couple at the end. And originally, like I said, I had a whole section that was just band shots, and I had a whole section that was backstage stuff. And there's a couple of, like, the picture of Kurt drinking from a cup and one outside the record store holding his head in his hands. And I mean, there's a couple things that sort of touch on that off stage. Mm-hmm. But what happens now is that those three or four portraits that are in the book, now they're so much more powerful.
Right.
Because they're only... You know, if I'd like, oh, I'm just going to like literally like publish every freaking shot on the roll because I think that's what people want. And, you know, there have been Nirvana and other band photo books where some photographer had one session with them and then, you know, tries to make a career out of it.
Yeah, I mean, a great example of that is just today you posted a couple of photos, one of which was Eddie Vedder kind of looking up into a spotlight in a just a black void. And you probably could have gotten 15 of those, but you chose one and it's like, wow, it pops out.
Yeah. Yeah. That's that one perfect moment, that iconic.
The right frame. Moment. Yeah.
The right frame. Yeah. Yeah, a funny story about that is that, you know, I flew out to Boston and the band lets me shoot the whole shows. And so what I often do is, like, when they come out, there's a good 20 or so photographers right under Eddie's nose. Mm-hmm. They just want to get that shot of him standing at the mic. So I just go off over, like, to the side of the pit. I was at the very far side and took that photo with a longer lens. I mean, it was just this beautiful black scrim that they had up. And then, yeah, I just one moment, you know, just like Eddie just is like lost and it's like the first or second song. And he's just sort of lost in that, like getting acclimated, I guess, to the whole experience.
Which is funny considering they had played it 2 years before. So it's not like he wasn't.
Well, yeah, no. I mean, and they'd played in Chicago a few days before or whatever. Right. But it's still, there was that, like, kind of like you could tell. He's like, okay, I got to, like, really take this all in before, like, we just start rocking out here.
Yeah.
You know, I'd take my jacket off and really kind of lose. But, and I just, it's a great portrait of an artist as an older man, really, too.
There's. Yeah, there's something, you look at something, you know, a photo you took of Eddie 92, there's just a different intensity that you compare that to something like this photo, and then there's just like a more calm wisdom. You can see the timeline, the 32 years or whatever it is in between those two photos, and be like, wow, there's more than just young guy, old guy here.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm, yeah. So yeah, I just have a way of chopping up the world in my eyes and brain and quickly translating that to the camera. It's what I do constantly. Like without a camera, I'm making photographs.
Well, speaking of being without a camera, you had a moment with Mark Lanegan where he fell into mud. And you wanted to take the photo, and he was like, no.
Yeah.
I got to find, and of course, I'm glad that he found that as funny as you did. What is, like, what's the most humbling in a fun way story you might have about a member of Pearl Jam in a similar way? Obviously not falling in mud, but, you know. Did anybody ever get, like, mistaken by security at a venue being like, you can't go back here, sir? And like, bro, I'm Stone Gossard. What are you talking about?
Well, what's funny is that, speaking of Stone, is that so like being on tour with them in Europe, obviously, like Eddie just had a really hard time going out and walking around. I mean, you look out of the hotel and you'd see groups of kids standing out under out on the sidewalk waiting for something, and but Stone, on the other hand, or maybe Mike or some of the other members. So one day in Keshke, Stone and I just went walking around. We walked past the venue. all these kids out front, you know, 2 p.m. partying already, just waiting there. We walk by, look at them, and we go to some silly little maritime museum or something in the town and just walk around. But I was like, said to Stone, like, do you want to walk by here? And he's like, oh, it'll be all right. And we walked past and nobody recognized him.
He's the most unrock star looking rock star.
Uh-huh. And so I had short hair at the time. I had short. We both had short hair, and yeah, we just walked by, and they just were like, "Oh, this is cool, whoever those guys are." So, My other absolute favorite moment with the band was, and Eddie to this day he kicks himself for not having joined us. And this was in Istanbul, when me and Jeff Ament and I think Tim Bierman and a couple other people, we went to a whirling dervish, a Sufi ceremony in the old part of town. It's not something that many people, this is not the one that the tourists go to. In fact, our young female guide, she's like, why do you want to go there? Don't you want to go to this rock club or whatever?
Like, no,
we're like, no, because Jeff knew this Italian journalist that was into that, and so he was like, I'm gonna take you guys to this really special experience. And yeah, it was mind-blowing. And I actually went back there several years later with my wife on our honeymoon in Istanbul.
That's fantastic.
Great incredible. City, right? Yeah, it is. It's my absolute favorite city, especially as a photographer. It's really wonderful.
Well, enjoy your 60th year.
Yeah, absolutely.
Thank you. Yeah. No, it's going to be a good one. And in fact, big news is museum show of the Nirvana book come fall.
Ooh,
yeah.
Nice.
The Tacoma Art Museum. Yeah. I think that by the time this is out, it will have been announced. So,
well, if you live in the Tacoma area,
yeah, October 5th, Tacoma Art Museum. And that was and the way we're developing that show is to have it travel.
Oh, well, I look forward to coming for it to come down here then.
Yeah, hopefully. So, you know, whoever picks it up institution-wise, and I think it shouldn't be a problem. I think anybody would want to have this show.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I'd love to see it. Well, but before we say goodbye, I want to end with this one, a little fun one. Can you think of a subject that you would have loved to have shot, but never got the chance to, and will never get the chance to?
Of a person?
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, actually, no, I did shoot her. Like, but I only got like half a roll. So
that's a roller coaster of emotions right there.
Yeah, yeah. I was like, oh, PJ Harvey. Oh, but yeah, no, but I do have a PJ Harvey shot. But from her first tour, like, I got off like 5 frames and then I was asked to stop taking photographs. So
that's the one that got away.
That's the one that got away. Oh, but oh my God. But yeah, there are definitely a lot of people I can think of that would have been amazing to photograph. James Brown, that would have been pretty crazy.
Ooh, yeah.
I'm trying to think rock and roll wise who I didn't get to shoot. Plenty. Radiohead, maybe.
You a Sam Cooke fan?
Yeah.
He's got that greatest hits vinyl. And the cover of it is just him sitting by a piano, and he just looks like the sky is falling. And it's such a contrast to the music that you're listening to. You know, he's so young in that. I thought it was just a fantastic image. Portrait of a Legend. You know, that was the name of the album.
You know what I would like to have shot more of is hip hop stuff back in the day. like Biggie and Tupac. I mean, I shot some for sure, but definitely some of that New York hip hop stuff. Yeah.
Cool.
And if you really want to put me in a time machine, just send me back. Just send me back to 77 England and the Roxy Music and the 101 Club and we're all good.
Back to Square One. I love it. Yeah.
I mean, yeah, that's probably the band that I would love to have shot, the Clash and the Pistols and all that. Yeah. Can't go wrong there.
No, you can't.
Well, I can't thank you enough for coming on and talking to us. I mean, we could be talking about this music and these shots for days, but you've got a big book coming out in a week, Charles Peterson's Nirvana. Charles Peterson, thank you.
Thank you, Charles.
Thank you.
And again, a hat tip, a kudos, and a thank you to Charles for taking all of that time to answer our questions and just talk about music and art and photography and, man, wealth of knowledge and wisdom.
Absolutely. And so many cool nuggets, too. I loved that informed luck part of our conversation.
Right?
That concept, and really enjoyed his approach to the Nirvana book, where it's about, hey, this could be any band, you know, like I'm trying to take these moments of them doing what they love, doing what they were known for, as opposed to these, you know, seemingly candid shots backstage, which yes, there's, the voyeur in us that wants to see them in a space that we ordinarily would not, that I get that. But at the same time, we're never going to see Nirvana on stage again. So is there any more, and let's be honest, is there a more fulfilling lens of that band than to see them in their element doing what we remember them for? So I love that approach that he took to this. Also really enjoyed that dichotomy there with his approach to trying to capture something that's iconic and you know, redefining what that is in terms of, you know, trying to represent what it is that you're doing versus interpreting it and channeling it through your own perspective and actually creating art. So,
and that perspective comes from years and years of doing it, learning new ways, learning by failure, reinventing things that have worked for others. And the fact that he did all that very quickly in a matter of what, maybe a decade from when he really truly started, is pretty remarkable. And we're still talking about these photos 30 years later, 25 years later. So go get that book. It is available for pre-order right now. It is out in 1 week's time, February 20th. There are book signings too. There's one at Sub Pop and there's one at Easy Street Records if you're in Seattle or want to go to Seattle. And as he mentioned, there might be a tour, a museum type tour around America. So, cool. So amazing stuff. Well, we'll be with you next week, and I think we might have to react to some new Pearl Jam.
We may have to. But by the way, Jason, are there any, for those of us who may be interested in joining Patreon, are there any perks from this interview that may be available?
Yeah, so there's going to be a little bit extra of the conversation that didn't quite make this show. That'll be there. And there's also a video on our Patreon of Charles going through, I don't know, 9 or 10 photos that he's taken, and just tell us what happened, when this was, what's the story behind it, and give us some context to some of these really indelible moments that he's captured on his film, on his camera. So those are things that you can get.
You can, and I have to tell you, I mean, you wouldn't think on the surface that it would be as engaging as it is, because I mentioned this in the Patreon clip, but I actually had the fortune of attending a session with Jimmy Page and Chris Cornell at the Ace Hotel in Los Angeles, where Chris sat with Jimmy and they projected a handful of, or a selection, I should say, of photographs from this photographic biography of Jimmy's. And Jimmy sat and basically unpacked what was behind those images for him. It was riveting stuff, man. There's so much context behind an image. They say a picture is worth 1,000 words. You know, you're getting 10,000 words behind all these images when you have a book like that. So highly encourage those of you, if you've been thinking about Patreon, this will be a great time to get in, just because having the opportunity to hear Charles talk about some of those iconic pictures of the bands that we love so much was incredible.
Yeah. And to go along with that, we did the same thing with Lance Mercer back last summer. Yeah. So you got both of those and the Behind the Poster series with Brad Clausen, episode 2 should be coming out in about a week or two. So
what a treat.
There's lots over there for you if you're interested in helping us keep these lights on. If not, feed the algorithm. That's also great. Or buy a shirt. You could do that too. That does cost money, whereas the algorithm is free. Just do the algorithm. Forget what I said. That helps everybody out. And it costs you nothing. All right, enough of that. Let's put a pin in it, and we'll see you next week. Maybe talking to Pearl Jam, Paul.
We hope.
Well, we'll see you next week. And until we do, you have been listening to
The State of Love and Trust.